we're going to be looking at what God wants us to do. We're asking the question, why pray? And really, today's answer may actually be because Jesus told us to. Now, that's an interesting one. Jesus told us to pray. He actually uses strong kind of words. It's like it's a command. It's not just a, you know, it'd be nice. It's something that we are supposed to do. And today we're going to look at Luke 10, and we're going to see that there's something really specific that he wants us praying for. He wants to influence us to action. Now, I want to remind you, though, what's the main reason for praying? Because God wants to have a relationship with us, right? Because we want to have a relationship with him. Prayer is about relationship. Prayer is not just about me coming up to say, Bobby, I want your drink. Yeah, thank you, thank you. Can I have your watch too? Yeah, thank you. Do you have any money?
I have no cash.
You have no cash. That's a real bummer. Can I have your keys? I'll take in truck and I'll hawk it or something, right?
I'll sell you my truck.
Yeah, you'll sell me? No, I'll just take it. You know, because don't we kind of do that with God? God, I want. God, help. God, give, right? Okay, and then we say, amen, see you later. Yeah. Bobby's like, I just got taken advantage of, ripped off, and now I don't have a truck. Someday we'll do something more with that one, though, okay, but that's another time. Prayer, it's not just about me coming, you know, I help me, whatever. And yet there's times we come to him desperate, right? And when we come to him desperate, when we come with a need, does he listen? You know, the amazing thing is he said he will do immeasurably beyond what we can think or even imagine. That means he can do better than what we even are going to ask for. That's pretty cool. So it's okay to ask God, but if that's all you're doing, oh my goodness. You are missing an incredible relationship. Because God wants to sit down with you and enjoy you and share his heart with you and let you share stories with him. God, John 15, says, Jesus says, no longer do I call you servants, but now I call you what? Friends. Friend, why? Because you see, you're spending life with me, Jesus says. That's what prayer is really about. Prayer is about a relationship with God, and God wants to get closer to you. Now, some of you are saying, I don't know why, right? Why would God want to get closer to you? Man, he's up there with the saints. Why would he want to get next to us? Well, it's this thing called love. God loves you. Loves you so much that he hung on a cross. And this is the crazy word, that he became sin for us. Whoa. That means it doesn't just touch him. It didn't just come into the room and smell bad. It says he became sin for us so that we could be set free from sin, so that we could be forgiven. Why? Because he loves us. So don't forget, prayer is about God wanting a relationship with you because he loves you. So today, Luke, the 10th chapter, we'll probably be bringing in some other pieces around because of what sets up Luke 10 is what's normal, the passage before it, right? Luke 9. And there will be stuff that follows the passage that we're going to read as well. But let's look at Luke 10. And at the moment, I'm just going to read the first 9 verses. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them 2 by 2 ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I'm sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say peace to this house. If a man of peace is there, your peace will rest on him. If not, it will return to you. Stay in that house, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcome, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them the kingdom of God is near you. How many of you have traveled to another country? Okay. How many of you have traveled to an unusual country? Okay. How many of you had unusual food in that unusual country? How many of you liked that unusual food? How many of you had some unusual food you didn't like? Matoki. Anybody know what matoki is? Nobody knows what matoki is. Matoki. So matoki looks like a banana, but it's not a banana. But it's the staple, kind of like rice is in some of the Asian countries. It's the staple for almost every meal, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And when you eat it that much, even once, it's boring. Okay? In Uganda, it's cooked, and it's kind of almost flavorless. And when we went to Uganda to do a mission trip there, we were served matoki. It's gross. Now, when you're served matoki in Uganda, what do? No, you're an American, you say, I don't eat stuff like that, right? Pretty good guest, aren't you? No, you eat it, and you don't complain till you get back to the U.S. But here's the interesting thing. Our hosts understood that matoki wasn't really going to settle well with us. So William Santumque used what little money he had to buy beef. And every night while we were there, he served us beef with our matoki. Because he was caring about us. Paul has some Luke has some interesting instructions here that Jesus gave these disciples, if you would, these 70 or 72. And I know some of your texts have 70, some of your texts have 72. And frankly, the number doesn't matter to me. 70, there's just as much historical evidence for 70 as there is for 72. 72 is a number of the groups of six, okay, so there's that. But then 70 also is 7 times 10. Both of those are perfection numbers and all. And there's different reasons why it would have been either one. And seriously, all the source evidence says it could be either. It's like 50-50, so what? But the fact is that there's a group of people, in addition to the 12 disciples, who are sent out by Jesus in groups of two, and they're supposed to go into communities, and they have a simple job. They're supposed to tell people that Jesus is coming, the kingdom is here, and they're supposed to heal the sick, and some of them will be actually casting out demons, and the kingdom is here, and they're supposed to simply go from town to town. They're supposed to bless them. What's it mean by to put the peace on people? Basically, it's saying shalom, the peace of God be with you. And if people accept that peace, and then they're welcomed into the house. If they don't accept it, then they leave there and go on. And if they don't find a house and people that will accept them, they leave the town. At the edge of the town, they shake the dust off their feet and roll on. And the whole point of shaking the dust is, I'm not coming back here. This community doesn't want God. We're leaving. We're not going to take time. We have a short time here, a short responsibility, a limited task, and we're supposed to go from town to town. So if this town doesn't want to listen, okay, that's their loss, not ours, and we simply have to move on. While we're there, we're not supposed to take a lot, or I should say on the journey, we don't take a lot of stuff with us because we're supposed to be moving quickly. We're not supposed to do things like a greeting. Well, that kind of sounds rude. Can you imagine Jesus telling people to be rude? When you're walking down the road and you see people, don't say hi to them. Is that what Jesus is saying? No, you have to understand that a greeting in their day was a rather elaborate experience. You would stop and you'd converse and you'd talk to this person, you'd learn about them and see where they're from. You'd find your relatives like we used to do in the Mennonite church. In the Mennonite church, there were all kinds of people coming from all the East Coast. They all had Swiss German names. And so you'd come up, you know, oh, hi, Chris, what's your last name?
Toast.
Toast?
No, Ghost.
K-O.
C-O.
C-O. S. S. C-O-S. Oh, sorry, you're not German. Dustin, what's your last name?
Steele.
Steele? Oh, you might be. No, you're not. Nathan, what's your last name?
Sanders.
No, you're not German. But you'd find somebody who's German, and then you'd say, oh, you're a Knopfsinger. Oh, you're a Brubaker. Oh, you're related to the Schwarzendrubers. And Mennonites were terrible about this. You know, like, it's been this time, you know. And then the person, you know, well, we don't want to talk to you. Oh, we don't want to talk to you. No, like, rude, no, right? But here's, Jesus is not saying be rude. He's saying, I don't want you to stop and take this long time for all this conversation that's really not mattering. Simply hi and keep going because you got to get to the next town. You're not taking a lot of stuff with you because you don't need it. You're not going to need money and stuff because you're going to stop in people's home and say, hi, God bless you. And if you accept the blessing, can I stay with you? Oh, can I take my blessing back? No. It was... As you went through these houses, you'd see whether you're welcomed or not. And so there's some simple instructions there. Now, is that the way we're supposed to go into the community to share Jesus? You're all like, I don't know, you tell me. We're waiting to find out. Well, okay, there may be some things that we can take from some of the parts of this, but really some of this is just about that job that they had. Jesus is there. He's moving from town to town. He's speaking and ministering, healing sick, casting out demons, proclaiming that he has come to set people free, right? He's giving the message of the kingdom of God to people. And as he's doing that, he's got these guys going out ahead to let them know that Jesus is coming. We don't generally have that same kind of experience, do we? No, we have something better. We move into a neighborhood. We move next to a neighbor. And Jesus is where? With us. So some of the practical stuff, the detail stuff here is simply about, if you're going on a quick short-term missionary journey, you don't waste time. You look for interest. Now there's some things that we may want to take away from this as well, but let's get back to the beginnings of the text. Notice what Jesus says, and this is a command. And notice who he says it to. He says to the 70, he says, guess what? I'm getting ready to send you out. So here, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out workers. What? Now wait a second. Aren't these guys going out? Aren't they going to go for a harvest? I mean, isn't that kind of their job? I mean, it sure seems like it. They're kind of like supposed to be kind of like lead evangelists, right? I mean, go down, prepare the way, kind of like John the Baptist did. You're supposed to go and get people ready and tell them that the kingdom is coming, which means Jesus is coming. That's the important thing, because isn't Jesus the king? You see, come kingdom of God is all about Jesus coming. So he's saying that Jesus, the kingdom is near, not just in time, but really literally in space. Jesus is behind us. He's coming down the road pretty soon here, and you're going to get a chance to meet him if you want to. And yet he says, pray to the Lord of the harvest, for the harvest is great, but the workers are few. It's a command for us that we are supposed to pray for workers. It's interesting. As these disciples are going out, they're supposed to be praying. And they're supposed to be praying for other workers. Now think carefully about that. Do you remember an instruction that Jesus gave to the 12 disciples as he's standing on a mountain and he says, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. Do you hear a similarity between that and what Jesus is saying here to these guys? He's saying, while you're going, I want you to be praying for others who are going to go, I want you to pray for harvest workers who are going to bring about a harvest. Isn't that what discipleship should be about? Should be about while we're going, because that's actually what Matthew 28 says, is while you're going out into your world, you have the responsibility of sharing about Christ and helping other people to come and obey. He's saying the same thing to us, isn't he? While we're going, we need to be praying to the Lord of the harvest to send out workers. Now here's the point. When Jesus asks us to pray for workers, who do you think he wants first? See, the 70, they're already going out there. They're already a worker. But when you start to pray for workers, how many of you know somebody who does not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Do you know him by name? How many of you have prayed for somebody to share Jesus with them? Guess who Jesus wants to share first? The person praying. The person praying. And so Jesus says, pray to the Lord of the harvest. To the guys that are already going out, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out workers. Because you see, it takes more than just one of us, doesn't it, to help somebody come to know Jesus Christ? It's not just about one person, but it's about other people also. It's about the community sharing Jesus Christ with other people. It's about the body of Christ, and we use all the gifts, and all of us have a role in that. Here's what's really cool. Well, I can't tell that story yet. I apologize. I get to do a wedding for somebody, and it's really, really cool. Because this person doesn't know Jesus. But I get to do the wedding. Okay, this is just cool, but I can't tell you anymore. So what's the job? What is the responsibility? What is the job of these workers that are going out, these 70 or 72? Because really, if we understand their job, we're going to understand something about our job. What are they told to do? Well, they actually are told, heal the sick and tell them that the kingdom of God has come near to you. Okay? Now, this is interesting because when Jesus did the same thing with the disciples, he actually added one more to that, and it seems like he may have given it to these guys as well, and he said, cast out demons. Now, just simple little things, right? So that's what I want you all to do, okay? I want you to leave here today. I want you to go out. I want you to cast out demons. I want you to heal the sick, and I want you to tell people that Jesus is here, okay? And as you do, God will give a harvest. Now, some of you are saying, wait a second, I've been scared and uncomfortable and not sure how to tell people about Jesus. I'm also supposed to cast out demons and heal the sick. I'm in trouble, aren't I? Yeah, if you're going to do it on your own. Now, I don't think that this text, again, is trying to say that we all should go out healing. But shouldn't we? When we go into the community and we meet somebody who has a need, shouldn't we be talking to God about that need?
Yes.
And maybe even grabbing their hand when they're saying, oh man, I'm really, you know, I'm afraid of going to the doctor because they're saying I've got to have this test and I don't want the test because I'm afraid of what they're going to find. Shouldn't we say, well, could I pray for you? No. Shouldn't we say, can I pray for you? Shouldn't we say, can I pray for you? Why? Because we want to involve them. Now listen, don't walk away and pray. Grab their hand and pray. That's why you ask them, may I pray for you? You're asking to do it literally right then. In that very moment, to grab their hand. And what if they don't believe? What if they think you're stupid, you're silly, you're weird? So? Because in those moments of crisis, they hope you might be right. They hope that prayer will work. Because in their own way, they're trying to pray too. So you see, there's a role for us to do. Yes, we should be going out and literally praying for sick. And in that sense, believing that God has the power to set people free from even demonic beings and demonic forces and powers of darkness. So what was their job? Heal the sick. Tell people the kingdom of God has come near. In Matthew 10, it says, these 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick. Raise the dead. That's an easy one. Cleanse those who have leprosy. Another easy one. Drive out demons. That may be the easiest of all of these, folks. Freely you have received, freely give. Whatever God has given to you, give it away, he's saying. Do you remember what Jesus said when he was instructing the disciples on how to pray? He says, okay, you guys want some instruction on prayer? Here's how you pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. We're doing the King James Version, but he did it in Aramaic, so don't get lost in that one, okay? Your kingdom come. Now stop right there. Because that's what Jesus is saying, that these guys are supposed to go out and tell people. The kingdom of God has come. In fact, the kingdom of God is coming closer than you've realized. Because God himself is here. Jesus of Nazareth, the Messiah, is here for you. The kingdom of God is available to you. So when we're praying, kingdom come, we're really praying, Jesus, you come and you be present for the people that you've sent us to in our community, our neighborhood. Mark 1 says, after John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. What's the kingdom of God? Jesus just told us. It's the good news. The kingdom of God is the gospel. It's the good news. What's the good news? Jesus loves you, died on the cross, rose from the dead, and if you believe in him, you can live forever. In fact, not just live forever, but you can have abundant life right now. God wants to be part of your life. That's the good news. That's the gospel. And you say it however you want to say it, communicate it what's easiest for you. But he says, that's the kingdom. That's the good news. Luke 4, Jesus said, the Spirit, he's standing right there in Nazareth, right? He's about to begin his ministry. They've handed him a scroll, and it's the scroll from Isaiah. And by chance, and he simply unrolls it, and what's by chance right there in front of him? You're right, chance. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, the kingdom. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, the kingdom. Recovery of sight for the blind, the kingdom. To set the oppressed free, the kingdom. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, the kingdom. He began by saying to them, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. Why? Because the kingdom is here. The kingdom has come. Where's Jesus? Where's the Spirit of Jesus Christ right now?
Living through as if we let him.
In you! Even if you don't let him, he's still in you, right? If you believe in Jesus, he's living in you, right? And so when you go into this community, the kingdom has come because Jesus is already with you. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit is with you. And so you're taking the kingdom into this community. And then Jesus warns them. He says, there's going to be opposition. He says, I just should tell you, I'm sending you out like lambs among wolves. It's going to get rough. You know, people aren't going to like you. There will be some. But you know, how many of you lost an arm or a leg, have been shot at because you believe in Jesus? How many of you had your head cut off because you believe in Jesus? I know you've heard the story of the family. in Syria. Voice of the Martyrs, which is a great ministry that I encourage you to follow, VOM International, tells a story of a young family that lives in Syria, and they knew that the ISIS soldiers were coming, and they sat down with their children. He said, well, we've been putting this off, but we need to talk to you. Someday, men may come to our door with black shrouds over their faces, and with swords in their hand. And they're going to ask us to reject Jesus and to commit ourselves to following them and Allah. And children, when they do, we're going to say, we love Jesus and we forgive you. And they said, children, when that happens, they're going to hurt us, and it'll hurt for a little while. But very quickly, we're all going to meet up with Jesus face to face. And what VOM tells us is that that family had that exact thing happen to them, and the whole family was slaughtered. So Jesus says, I'm sending you out like lambs among wolves. And lambs don't fight well, do they? they're terrible about it. However, the couple things that protect a lamb. Get this one. Couple things that protect a lamb. The other lambs staying close together. And the shepherd. They protect the lamb. That's why God called us to be body. Lambs protecting one another by staying close together. And the shepherd's there to protect us, to walk us through the valley. And if it comes and the wolves attack, to take us home to the place that he's prepared for us. There's going to be opposition. Matthew 10, to the disciples, a similar, he kind of expands on it. He says, I'm sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore, be as shrewd as snakes, not telling us to be snakes, and as innocent as doves. Be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. It's going to get worse than that. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say. For it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. It was the Spirit that enabled those parents to talk to those children. It was the Holy Spirit that enabled that family to face their own death, and a painful one. It was the Holy Spirit that took Stephen when he was about to be stoned and gave him the ability to speak, Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing right now. It was the Holy Spirit that was at work in people throughout history that have died for Jesus Christ, standing up for him. And it's the Holy Spirit. And guess what? The Holy Spirit doesn't need to give you that power right now. No one's standing in front of you with a sword. None of you are in jail right now. But if that happens to you, if you're one of those who's called to put your life on the line for Jesus Christ in that moment and only in that moment, when you need it most, God will give you what you need. The Holy Spirit will equip you, give you the words to say, give you the strength to endure, and even enable you to handle the pain, however bad it hurts. And on the other side, he'll be standing there welcoming you as one of his saints in glory. And some of you may be afraid of that moment. And that is normal. When these parents are talking with these children, they weren't saying, you know, oh, this is going to be fun. You know, we're going to hurt and we're going to die. And then it's, yay, whoopee. No. And they were sharing with these children because they were afraid. But they knew that even though afraid, that God was going to be there for them and with them. So folks, you know one of the main reasons why people don't share Jesus with their neighbor? It's fear. Now, I know some of us have weird neighbors. Some of you are our neighbors. Just saying. Some of you, I mean, see, I know there's strange people out there. And that's why Jesus said, okay, you know what? If there's reception, share. If there's not reception, move on. But folks, if you're going to move on from somebody, then don't just do it by in your head. Okay, I'm not going to talk to you about Jesus anymore. You were mean to me. No. Make sure you've talked at least then before you do that. But then secondly, if once you've actually talked to somebody about Jesus and they're saying, no, I don't want it, then you say, you know what? I want to continue to be a good neighbor to you. But I'm not going to share Jesus anymore with you. I'm never again going to tell you the way to know Christ. I'm never again going to point the way to heaven for you. I'm never again going to invite you to experience his love. I understand you don't want it. So I'll never share it again. You see what happens when you do that. Because don't forget, God is the one touching hearts. God is the one who will speak to them in that moment. And you might be surprised at what God does for them. Because you've said, I care so much about you that I'm going to stop pounding this Bible stuff at you. And I'm just going to leave you in whatever you believe. Folks, one of the things that comes out of this text is that rejection of Jesus is rejection of God. Now, I know that there are people who believe that every road leads to God, but that's not what Jesus says. Therefore, every road can't lead to God. In fact, because Jesus says he's the only way to God, if every road leads to God, Jesus doesn't lead to God. Do you get it? Jesus is saying, when you reject me, you reject the Father who sent me. In fact, he'll go on with that. In Luke 10, he says, whoever listens to you listens to me. Whoever rejects you rejects me. But whoever rejects me rejects him who sent me. It's Jesus, or it's all those roads and not Jesus. It's not Jesus end. And that's what Jesus is trying to say. Luke 10:20 says, however, do not rejoice. Just before I make that comment. The 70 come back and they say, Jesus, whoa, this is wonderful. People were healed. Demons listened to us. And Jesus said, yes. In fact, while you were out, I'm watching what was happening. And listen, I saw Satan falling like lightning from heaven. Now, you don't fall like lightning, do you? It kind of goes, to-do. He says, I saw Satan going, to-do, like from heaven. I mean, he just cast out. I saw that. But then he goes on. He says, but listen, folks. Don't get all excited about that. There's really only one thing to be excited about. That your names are written in heaven. That your names are there in the book of life in heaven. And Jesus is again saying it. There's only one way. And that is you got to have your name written in the book of life. And how do you get your name written there? Jesus writes it. And I imagine with his blood. So, however, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Did I ask you the question at the beginning? Do you pray for people to come to know Jesus? Do you pray for the harvest? Do we really want God's kingdom to come? Then shouldn't we be praying for people to go out, for harvest workers to go out where God sends them to share the love of God with them? Shouldn't we be praying that? And when we're praying that, shouldn't we be prepared to be the answer to our own prayer? Because God may actually say, you want somebody to go? Yes, go. You want somebody to speak to that neighbor? Yes, that's why I put it in your heart. That's why I put that burden on your soul. Do it. You want somebody to communicate with your brother, your sister, your mother, your father? Yes. No one cares more about them than you, so be the one. Oh, not me. Are you praying for the harvest? And are you willing to be the answer to the prayer? Do you know why Jesus told these 70 to pray it? Because they had the burden. They had such a burden. They had such faith in Jesus Christ that they're going. They're already going. They're the best ones to pray for more to go because they already get it. People are on their way to hell without Jesus. They get it. And they care enough about even their enemies to go and to share. Do you understand that people need the Lord? Worship team, please come. You can't share what you don't have. Did you know that? I asked Bobby for money and he had none. What's he think? You can't share what you don't have. If you don't have Jesus living in your life, you can't share him with somebody else. So have you said yes to Jesus? I know it really is a simple question and it's a simple answer. It's a yes or a no. Have you said yes to Jesus? Have you said, yes, Jesus, I accept the fact that you died on that cross for me. I accept the fact that you love me. I may not totally comprehend it. I may not be able to totally understand it. But yes, I believe that. If you've never done that, or if you're a person who's been sitting in a church for 99 years, and you, oh yeah, I believe in God, I believe in God, but you've never shared it, guess what? Maybe you don't believe it. So first I'm asking, if you haven't said yes to Jesus, I invite you to do it right now. You know what? The language you use and how you say it doesn't really matter. You can be like a biker and say it with a lot of color. Not like you, Mike. More color. You can say it with, you know, language that we don't talk like that. And God just says, just be honest with me. I'm a messed up person. Come into my life, Jesus. I want you here. But then, are you willing to let that Jesus who has come in your life be visible so that other people can know him? I challenge you. That world is in trouble out there. And the reason Jesus is saying pray to the Lord of the harvest, because the harvest is great, but there's not enough of us that are going out there caring. Would you pray that God would move people to go to the harvest? And if you really pray that prayer, would you pray, and God, if you want it to be me, show me to who? Father God, thank you for your love. Thank you for dying on that cross. Thank you for coming into our community. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for loving each person that's here. Help them to believe. Holy Spirit, help us to feel what you feel, the burden you carry for a world that is lost. and send out workers. And let us be a part of the harvest. In Jesus' name.